Hi friends, welcome to the Bible Project Daily Podcast. Today we begin a three-day journey through John chapter 17. And I've called today's message, The Real Lord's Prayer. Now when we think of the Lord's Prayer, most of us, I would imagine, would immediately recall the prayer recorded in Matthew chapter 6. You know, that one begins, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now technically, that prayer is in fact probably more accurately described as the disciples' prayer. When the Lord spoke these words, he said them to the disciples, and he said to them, when you pray, pray like this. And then he gave them those words that we're all so familiar with. But if you want to find an actual prayer that the Lord prayed, so in a sense the real Lord's Prayer, the prayer he prayed for himself, you have to turn to John chapter 17. Now in our studies together through the Gospel of John, we've today reached this important chapter. And it is indeed one that many says contains the deepest portions of the Word of God that you'll actually find perhaps anywhere in the whole Bible. Now it's going to take some time to work our way through the chapter and all the detail that's contained here. One expositor many years ago said that John's chapter 17 contains, let me quote, although using the simplest language, it has the most profound meaning of any chapter in the Bible. One Bible commentator who was a friend and colleague of D.L. Moody wrote a whole 450-page book just on John chapter 17. And another very famous preacher here in the UK, a man called Martin Lloyd-Jones, who was based in Westminster Chapel in London, in the early 1960s preached a series of sermons through this one chapter that lasted for 45 sermons. Now, relax folks, I don't plan to do that, but I do plan for us to spend 3 episodes studying this chapter because it merits it. And I'll just quote another British pastor, a guy called John Stott, well known in the UK. He said this a few years ago when he studied it, we cannot plumb its depths, but we can paddle in the shallows of John 17 for a little while. And that's what I hope, and that's what I'd like for us to do, to paddle through this great chapter today and look at what some people call the real Lord's Prayer. But before reading the prayer, I have to say, studying it provokes questions in my mind, perhaps in yours. If he prayed, what, if anything, did he ask for? And if he prayed for someone else, for whom did he pray? And then what can I learn from studying this prayer of the Lord in this chapter? And these are some of the questions that I think, I hope, I will answer for you as we look together through the real Lord's Prayer in John chapter 17. So welcome to today's episode of the Bible Project Daily Podcast. Okay, now this chapter has been divided into 3 parts by many people who've approached it. In the first 5 verses, which we're looking at today, the Lord, we will see, begins by praying for himself. Then, in verses 6 through 19, we see him pray for the apostles. And in the later part of the passage and the prayer, beginning at verse 20 and going through to the end of the chapter, he prays for those who would believe because of the ministry of the apostles, the subsequent believers who follows on, which of course includes all believers from the time of the apostles right down to you and I today. So this prayer, I think, very naturally falls into 3 parts. So let's begin by today looking at what the Lord asked for himself. Let me read the passage for you. Verse 1 to 5 says this. After Jesus said this, he looked up towards heaven and prayed. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you have granted him authority over all people, that he might have eternal life, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Okay, the first thing I have to say is, you may notice that there's a phrase here, and as we've journeyed through the Gospel of John, we've met this phrase several times, and that is, my hour is not yet come. And this phrase, most Bible experts agree, is a reference to the cross. For Jesus' life, it represents the climax, the high point of it, spiritually the high point, and we find it at the cross of Calvary. To him, the cross was the glory of his life and the way for him and those who follow the way of the cross as the way to the glory of eternity. But this time he says the hour has come, and he says it is the hour for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now, he first said this statement way back in John 12:23. But what did he mean when he repeatedly spoke of the cross and when he referenced it as being his glory and his glorification? Well, there's actually more than one answer to that question. It is one of the facts of history that again and again that it is in death that we will see people will often find their greatest glory. It is when they die or how they die, which in a way shows people what and who people really were, and if their testimony was authentic in the sense they were prepared to die for it. Now, in their lifetime, they may have been misunderstood people, undervalued, even condemned as criminals in their lives at that time, but their deaths, in a sense, show their true place in the great scheme of things. Abraham Lincoln, I think, was some such man. He had his enemies during his lifetime, of course, and even those who criticised him, many would see his greatness when he died. Stanton, his war minister, always regarded Lincoln as a bit of a crude and unprofessional man, and he took no pains to conceal his disapproval of him while he was alive. Yet he looked down at his dead body, and it was written that he had tears in his eyes and said, "There lies," he said, "the greatest ruler of men the world has ever seen." Joan of Arc, a French woman, burned as a witch and a heretic by the English. Amid the crowd, there was said to be an Englishman, one of the actual secretaries of the king, who had been involved in the manipulation and the creation of this woman's persecution and death. In fact, in its preparation, he had sworn that he himself would add a log to the fire, was said to have left the scene saying, "We are all lost because we have burned the saint." So again and again, we have seen that a martyr's glory has really only emerged through their death. And it was so the template was set by Jesus himself. Jesus, even before the centurion at the foot of the cross, was, do you remember, he is left saying, "Truly this man was the Son of God." The cross was indeed the glory of Jesus, because on it he was never more awesome and majestic and powerful in reality than in his death. The death was his glory because it was the thing that would draw men and women to him in a way that even his life and his ministry could not do, and certainly would not do to this day if it were that alone. But in addition, the cross was the glory of Jesus because it was the completion of his work, his mission on earth. "It is finished. I have accomplished this work," he said as he died there. One of his final words, the final words he actually uttered from the cross. For Jesus to have stopped short of the cross would have indeed meant to leave his task, his mission, uncompleted. Jesus had come in the world to tell men and women about the love of God, more than tell them, to show it to them. And if he had stopped short of the cross, it would have been to say in a way that God's love would only go this far and no further. But by going to the cross, Jesus showed that there was nothing that the love of God was not prepared to do or endure for humanity. There was literally no limit to the love of God in Christ. And that is exactly what Jesus did. He completed his task and he brought God's love to men in its entirety. And for him, that meant the cross. And the cross was his glory because upon it he finished the work that God had given him to do. But there is another question. How did the cross and Jesus' willingness to go to it and endure what he endured on it, how in reality does that glorify God? Well, I would say that the only way, the high point of truly glorifying God, is simply to obey him. If you think about it, a child brings honour, glory, if you like, to his or her parents by the way they live, by living the way that they want he or she to live. And a citizen brings honour to their country when they obey its reasonable laws. A student brings honour to his teacher when he obeys his teacher's instructions and chooses to work diligently. And Jesus brings glory and honour to God ultimately by his perfect obedience to him, even obedience to the cross. You see, the gospel story does make it clear that Jesus could have had an out. He could have chosen not to obey his father. He could have escaped the cross. Humanly speaking, he could have turned his back upon it, and he need never have even have gone to Jerusalem in the first place. But he did, and he did it willingly, and because of that we can look at Jesus in his last days and see how much he loved God and how willing he was to be obedient to the will of his Father. We can see to what lengths his obedience was willing to go. And because it went to the ultimate length, he glorified God on the cross by rendering perfect obedience to out of perfect love to his Father, out of a perfect love for him. But there's still more here. The cross is seen as the glory of God because it is not the end of all things. There is a resurrection to follow, and that is the vindication of Jesus. It's the proof that men could do their worst, but Jesus could still triumph. It's a story of the limits of what the extremes of how we can illustrate this story. It's the worst of possible things happening to the best of possible men. The cross was the worst that men could do to Jesus. But even that would not conquer him. The glory of the resurrection obliterated man's schemes and attempt to put shame and death upon him on the cross. You see, for Jesus, the cross was in fact the way back, not only for him, but for all of us. For him, it was the very gateway to back to glory itself. And if he had chosen to refuse to go that journey, to take that path, refuse to pass through it, then there would have been no glory for him to enter into, and no glory for us to enter into in the future. For Jesus, the cross was his return to Father God. Now, there's another important thought in this passage, and also contains for us a great New Testament definition of what eternal life really is and means. And it is that eternal life is to know God and to know Jesus Christ, whom he sent. Eternal life is inherited at the moment we come to understand that our life should be nothing more than a willingness to seek out and live the life of God, to possess it, if you like, to enter into it, to experience it here on this earth in the now, is to know something of the splendour and the majesty and the joy and the peace and the holiness which is to come, which are all the characteristics of living the life of God, a life of God that can begin for us today but continue into eternity. To know God as a goal has always been a distinctive thought of the Old Testament. Wisdom is a tree of life to those who lay hold of it, we're told in Proverbs 3:18. By knowledge are the righteous delivered, we are also told in Proverbs 11, verse 9. Habakkuk's dream of the golden age is that the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God. Hosea hears God's voice saying to him, "My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge of God." Proverbs 3:6 tells us, "Know him, and he shall direct thy paths. Seek me and live," says Amos. For Amos, seeking God also meant spending a life trying to get to know him. But if we're called to know God, what does it mean to know God? Now, undoubtedly, there is an element of intellectual knowledge. We know things, that is true, and we know things about God, but there are some things we can never know or never could have known about him unless Jesus had come to earth to show us and tell us what God was really like. Through the life and work of Jesus, we is the only way we can discover what God is really like. You see, to know God is not merely to have an intellectual knowledge about him, it's to know him and to know him personally, to have an intimate personal relationship with him, a bit like that of the nearest and dearest relationship we can have in our lives, a family relationship. And once again, without Jesus incarnating on earth, such intimacy with God would have been unthinkable, impossible for us to even have understood, never mind seen or replicated. It is Jesus who shows us that God is not any more, any longer, the remote and unapproachable one. He is revealed as the Father whose name and nature are love. And to know God is now to know what he is like and to be in the most intimate terms of friendship with him. And neither of these things, none of these things, are possible without Jesus Christ. But to glorify God also means to not just to reveal him, but actually to go beyond that, to make him manifest. And John 16 verse 14 provided us with a clear definition of this. He says, he will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. Jesus is asking the Father to fully manifest, fully reveal himself through the cross. The cross and what happened there is indeed the full revelation of God's love in Jesus Christ, showcasing for us not just Jesus's deity, but his love and sacrifice as mirroring the character of the Father as well. On the cross, Jesus becomes our substitute. He dies in our place for our sins, but it is through the cross that Jesus' love is made evident, because the Father was willing to offer up his Son, his only Son, as a sacrifice for our sins. He literally died for us. Greater love hath no man than he lays down his life for his brother or sister. Now Jesus prays here to be glorified in all these ways, but his motivation for doing it is that through him people can witness, can see the glory of the Father. This means that through the cross the Father's love and goodness were revealed in their totality. As John Calvin wrote centuries ago, in the cross of Christ is a splendid theatre of the incomparable goodness of God set before the whole world. The cross stands as the ultimate display of God's love, the ultimate way to understand and see what God is like, because it shows both Jesus' love and the Father's goodness and desire for us to be in that close, intimate relationship with him. But Jesus closes out this little short section of the prayer for himself by explaining that his glorification also serves the purpose of securing salvation. He prays, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. So through the cross, Jesus has been given the authority, it's been handed to him, the authority to grant eternal life. And eternal life is defined as knowing the only true God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent, and that it begins at the point in time where we embrace that. But Jesus continues to pray for his glorification, not just on the cross, but also beyond the cross, in the future, into heaven. In verses 4 and 5, he closes off this little opening section by saying, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. So Jesus is now asking to be restored here through the cross to his pre-incarnate glory where he was and with the Father at his right hand side. Jesus prays here in John 17, and this prayer for himself is indeed profound. He's asking to be glorified in all these ways, but also in his future restoration back to glory where he had sat before even the world began. Now, quite honestly, I think much of this is beyond our comprehension. We can't really even imagine what the glory of Jesus Christ was like with the Father before he became incarnate upon the earth. We have glimpses of it in Ezekiel. We have glimpses of it elsewhere. But we see it and experience it through a glass darkly in these days. He had come and was revealing God the Father to us, but now he's saying that having done that, he is saying that after he dies on the cross and is resurrected, that he be glorified, put back in his former state that he was again in heaven before this all began. The introduction to Hebrews, I think, gives us a little bit of an insight to what's going on here. It says, in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. Through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he has provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of his majesty in heaven. Now, there's elements of this that are beyond my wildest imaginings in being able to understand. But I can simply say that what he's asking for when he prayed for was himself to be glorified to that previous state. Have you ever grasped hold of the fact that this Hebrews passage is telling us that Jesus existed in heaven and all of creation, all of the creative process was upheld and sustained by his powerful word? And this is where we are. That's what he's praying for. That's the state he's praying he be called back into. So here we see in this first part of what I've called the real Lord's Prayer is him praying for himself. And it can be summed up in one word, glorification. That he be glorified, that the Father be glorified, and what it means for him that he had to be glorified by enduring the cross on earth in order to return to his Father in heaven. But it seems to me, as we progress further through this chapter, we will see he wants also to be glorified in our relationship with him and our relationships with one another. And that's what we look at next time. Thanks for being with me today. Friends, hi everybody, welcome back to another episode. Today's episode of the Bible Project Daily Podcast. In today's podcast, we're going to continue to delve deeply into the heart of this particular passage of Scripture to uncover the truths and how they can shape our lives today. I'm your host, Jeremy McCandless, with you every day, Monday to Friday, to help you navigate this amazing journey together through the whole Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. I'm thrilled that you're here with me today. And today we're going to continue our third in our short series on what I've called the real Lord's Prayer. Now, in the last two episodes, we explored Jesus's prayer for himself and then how he prayed for his apostles. Now we turn to the climax of this important prayer. Jesus has seemed to pray for all who choose to follow him. Yes, that means indeed he prayed for you and for me, and he's been doing that long before we were even born. So imagine the scene. Jesus here, knowing the weight of the cross is imminent, he pauses to pray for us and for all future believers. His words thereby transcend both time and space, and they have the ability to reach into the very fabric of your life today. Why incredible is that? Because in John 17 verses 20 to 25, in the last little portion of verses in this prayer, Jesus speaks to the Father about our unity as believers, our sanctification through him, and our mission in the world. These verses hold important, yes, I'd say profound implications for you and I on our faith journey, as well as our relationships with one another, in fact, our very purpose in life. So again, find a quiet spot and get ready to be inspired, not by me, but by the Word of God and the Word of Jesus Christ. And whether you're a long-time believer or a new follower of Christ, or simply someone just curious about the Christian faith, I believe this episode can be for you. So together, let's dive into the words that Jesus himself prayed, and he prayed them with you and I in mind. So welcome to today's episode of the Bible Project Daily Podcast. Okay, this is the prayer. And my prayer is that it helps you able to change the way that you see your personal relationship with God and also discover your role in his amazing story and plan for you. And in my Bible translation, the NIV, these few verses are actually have a title over them that says Jesus prays for all believers. Very apt. He says this, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." Now, when he's saying message, he's talking about the people subsequently who will believe in the message that he talks about as having been given to the apostles who he prayed about yesterday. Verse 21, "that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them, and you in me, so that they all may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them." Wow. That's it. So in this final part of this prayer that Jesus makes, the Lord's Prayer, Jesus focuses on his disciples. His disciples who will follow on subsequently to those of the apostles. And he's asking the Father to keep these people. Now I'm going to say to keep us from here on in. He's asking God to keep us and to sanctify us. And he emphasizes the importance of being able to be in that place lies in the fact that we can be in the world, but be not of the world. So he doesn't pray for, as I put it yesterday, he doesn't pray for our isolation from the world, but he prays for our insulation from the sinful effects of the world. He wants us to remain untouched by the world's sinfulness whilst we still actively are engaging with it. We are to be in the world, but the analogy often used is like a ship in water, but not allowing any water inside the ship. Sanctification is therefore a cooperative process involving both God and us. Jesus now sends his people into the world, and the Father is seen to sanctify us through his truth, the Word. So this, I would suggest, very clearly tells us that it involves a daily commitment to living out his word and by being his representatives in the world. Now, I think all of these references indicate that our unity is achieved ultimately through our shared understanding of the Word of God and ministering it to one another. Now, there is the popular idea that the truth divides, and that is in a sense true. It is by nature the thing that creates a division, a line in the sand, of course, no less between things that are true and things that are wrong, things that are in error. But as I understand the prayer the Lord is praying in this passage, it is apparent that through the word of his word, and thereby the word of his apostles, which of course today we see incorporated into the New Testament scriptures, it is through those things that we are going to be united. Jesus points not only to his own words, but the fact that the words that the apostles are going to carry, both through their evangelism in the world and through their written recording and witnessing of the events and teaching on them that we see in the New Testament Gospels and letters, that it is through those things that unity is ultimately going to be obtained through the Word of God, through His faith community. It is by this we can be united in the world, united through the Word. But there's one other things he asked for. So he not only asks that we be unified, but he also asks that we too be glorified. Listen again to verse 24. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, to see my glory and the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. So he prays that we would be glorified also, expressing his desire for believers one day to be with him in heaven and witness his full glory. Now, this prayer is significant because it emphasizes that any prayer Jesus prays, well, we know it will certainly be answered. In fact, Jesus says, Father, I desire that these things happen, showing his intention, his will in this, a will that he says will be fulfilled. And he is expressing his will for us that we will be glorified and that we indeed will be with him in heaven, in paradise. So notice this phrase, Father, I desire that they also whom you gave me may be with me. This shows Jesus expressing his will, his desire for us. We often remember Jesus praying, not my will, but yours be done. But here he states his own will is the thing based upon what he desires and who he is for us. So in some ways, people, I think, have rightly described this almost as what we would call in worldly terms, a last will and testament of Jesus before he leaves, where his desire is declared that he wants us ultimately, the result of everything, that we end up with him and God, with him in glory. Now, this is a deeply, deeply profound passage of scripture we've been considering the last few days, and we've only touched the surface of it these last few days. As I've said, Martin Lloyd-Jones preached for 45 Sunday evenings on this in his pulpit. Whole books have been written about this passage of scripture. There is so much depth in this passage of John that I could have gone into much more detail, but I think that's as far as we can go into it today if we're ever going to get through the whole Bible together within the 10 years that I'm hoping. So let me just try and summarize what I believe the Lord is praying for and about here. He's praying for himself to be glorified. That was on day one of our study within the main study of John. Then on day two, he prays for his apostles, those people who were following on that day, for them to be sanctified. And then ultimately today, on the third day, we've seen him pray for all believers that we be unified and that we experience glory with him in the future. There is a sense in which we already possess what he has already prayed for us, because Ephesians 4 actually tells us what our job is now, to endeavour to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace, showing in a sense that we already have that unity of the Spirit because we have come to know him as our personal Saviour. That thing that he has prayed for is to a great extent fulfilled, and that promise can be claimed by embracing it as believers in him, showing that we already have the unity that he is praying for here. Romans 8 tells us that we are simply in a place where we await our future glorification. But I would also suggest that passages like Romans and Ephesians would also suggest that there is some work to be done towards these goals, not in the end result, but in how they will benefit us in this life and others in this life, and the crowns of righteousness we will receive in glory. We need to be actively involved in expressing the glory that Jesus Christ has bought for us. We are to be actively striving for sanctification in our lives through the truth of God's word, because that is how we will find true unity. But it involves a certain amount of diligence, a pursuit of it, if you like, on our behalf. Jesus' prayer calls for us to glorify him by being sanctified in him, by being unified in him. And as we've seen, there's no shorthand to that. We get to do that by knowing him in person, by name, and that is achieved through understanding his character, his life, his ministry, what he's done through his death and resurrection, and by applying it into our lives. But let me make another final suggestion. Could it just be that all these three things over these 3 days we've looked at are all related to one another? If we were glorifying Christ, wouldn't that simply by nature lead to our sanctification? And if we're glorifying Christ and then by nature being sanctified, wouldn't that also then naturally result in a very real and genuine unity amongst us? Doesn't that just make sense? Of course it will. It's really all about the purpose and motive and posture of our hearts. It is about our intent and our desire to manifest Jesus Christ. And by doing that, by diligently seeking that out, he will sanctify us and unity will follow. When we focus on glorifying Christ and make that the main call of our life, sanctification simply becomes a byproduct of that, I believe. We wouldn't have to worry so much about being sanctified. It's not something we'll have to strive for in that sense, because it will be naturally happening if we are obedient to searching and seeking him out through his word and by his spirit. And similarly, then out of that, unity itself should come easily and naturally. The very fact that we practice biblical principles like meekness, humility, and submission to one another, putting other believers first, that by nature must foster unity and must reduce division. Let's look at it another way. Many people talk about me and the me generation, where everyone is seen to now primarily be concerned with themselves. And the underlying intent of living and thinking that way is often actually to glorify oneself. This mindset leads to division and dissension, because at the core, we are actually, well, the clue is in what we say. It's ultimately about me. It becomes about my rights, my needs, my desires. But now, taking this on board and what Jesus has prayed for us, suppose we choose to let our focus shift. Suppose our primary aim is now to manifest Jesus Christ in every situation, striving to be like the Lord, to serve other people like the Lord, striving for holiness. Then by nature, unity will naturally replace division, dissension and division amongst us and in the communities in which we live. You know, a few years ago, I remember talking to a married couple who'd been struggling, and I did pick up the fact over a few sessions spent with them. It seemed to me that each partner underneath was insisting that it was the other that needed to change. And after listening to this for several weeks, I simply pointed out to them that they were waiting for the other person to change. And by each of them setting their heart on the fact that they believed the other person needed to change, they'd simply reached a stalemate. I told them what they needed to do was to decide and think about and pray about what God told them to do in regard to that other person and how they might support them. And I believe that principle is core to our Christian identity and faith. When we set our hearts on manifesting Christ, on doing what he wants to do, putting other people first, personal agendas will fade away, and of course by nature unity will follow. So let me ask you a question. When people meet you and get to know you, do they see the Lord in you, manifesting in you? Are you manifesting His love, His joy, His peace, His gentleness, His patience, His self-control, His graciousness? All of these are the fruit of the Holy Spirit of God, we're told in picture. All of these are the very things we're meant to be manifesting. Is that what people see when they look at you? Or do people look at you and sometimes see someone who just wants to stand up for their own rights and fight that battle? So as we draw close to this third episode in this series of three, looking at what I've called, I hope you don't think disrespectfully, the real Lord's Prayer, let's take a moment to reflect on the truths that it has revealed to us today and these past days. Jesus, at this point, knowing the immense sacrifice he is about to make, made the choice to pause and to pray specifically for you and for me. How awe-inspiring is that? In this closing section, we witness Jesus' heartfelt prayer for our unity, our sanctification, and our mission. He's now not praying for his immediate disciples, but for every believer who would come after them. And that means that's you and that's me, folks. That's all of us. And he's praying for us to be united by his love and his sacrifice. And let's remember that when Jesus chose to pray for us, he prayed for our unity. Now, we live in a world that is increasingly divided. Our countries, our nations are divided politically and through all sorts of areas of identity and identity politics. But he called for us as Christian believers to simply be one, just as he and the Father are one. This unity is not just a lofty political ideal. It's a powerful witness to the world of God's love and truth. We're meant to, in some way, reflect in this season the unity of the Holy Spirit as described in Revelation of the breadth of unity across the church worshipping God in heaven. Now, Jesus, in doing this, remember, he also prayed for our sanctifications, and he does this because he knows we will face challenges, temptations, and trials. Yet he prayed that we would continue to be set apart and not come under the effect of those challenges and temptations, and that we would be made holy. And remember, the way he tells us to do that is through the truth of his word. So this prayer is a daily call for you and I to live out our faith authentically. And we do that by allowing his word, submitting to his word, is allowing his word to transform us from the inside out. And then finally, Jesus is seen here. He actually prays for our mission in the world. He didn't ask for us to be taken out of the world, but to be protected from the evil one and the effects of the world as we carry out his mission. As it says elsewhere in Scripture, we're called to be salt and light. We're called to be the people who bring hope, love, and truth to a world desperately in need of his gospel. So as you go about your week this week, remember this: Jesus has prayed for you. Jesus continues to pray for you. He interceded on your behalf here, and in doing so, he is ensuring that you and telling us that we will have everything we need to live the life of faith, purpose, and to see that life have an impact in the world. So I hope you find that helpful. Thank you for joining me on this journey through what I've called the Lord's Prayer these last 3 days. And I hope you feel encouraged, uplifted, particularly by the fact that he's prayed for you, you and I, ourselves, and thereby you feel ready to take on whatever comes your way with confidence in knowing that Jesus not only prayed then, but he's seated at the right hand of the Father, Romans tells us, interceding on your behalf right now. So until next time, keep that faith, keep that posture of heart, stay united, and let your light shine brightly for all to see. This is Jeremy McCandless signing off from today's episode of the Bible Project Daily Podcast. Welcome to the Bible Project Daily Podcast. And today we're in the second part of our little mini-series within this wider series looking at John's Gospel, where I'm, for these 3 days, looking at what I call the real Lord's Prayer. And in the second part, we're going to see Jesus pray for his apostles. And the text we're going to be covering today is John chapter 17, verses 6 through to 19. So this is part of this longer section of the Lord's Prayer. We first of all saw the Lord pray for himself, and that could all be summarized in one word, that he prayed that he might be glorified, meaning that he might be glorified on the cross, but also glorified by his return to heaven. But there is an element in all this that he also wants to be glorified in our relationship with him, and how that works out with our relationships with one another. Jesus desires to be glorified through his life, but also through the cross, the thing that was meant to represent his humility. He wants that event to actually be revealed as the loving sacrificial substitute for all of humanity. But additionally, beyond that, then he prays to seek and see the fact that he will be glorified in heaven with the Father. In other words, that the glory that he previously had is re-established just as it was before he came upon the earth. But also, we will later find out that Jesus also wants to be glorified in you and me, folks. He wants others to see him through our actions, our words, and the very manners in which we conduct ourselves. Our words and our lives are meant to minister grace to other people, to anyone who hears us, in fact. Our very presence should reflect Jesus Christ to others. When people are in our presence, they should sense there's something different about us. Not just by our actions and our speech, but by our whole being. It should be characterized by a sense of grace because of the relationship we have with Jesus Christ, which in the end was not of our merit. It in itself was offered by grace. But more about that tomorrow. Do you remember the fact that the Lord, in one of his final acts on the cross, he will be seen to bow his Father and say, "Father, the hour has come." And that hour he's talking about, that is the hour he's talking about in which his glory is manifest. And here we see this glory explored through all its levels, through this prayer the Lord is making. Glorify me in the cross, that I may by it secure salvation for men and women. Glorify me in heaven, and returning me to sit at the right hand of the Father. And glorify me in those who are mine after I've gone. May others thereafter see me in them. So his prayer, this lengthy prayer that covers all of the 17th chapter, he makes petitions in it, requests if you like. The first we saw yesterday, in a sense, was for himself, that his glory be manifest and revealed. But after this opening part of the prayer, he is now going to pray for the apostles, those guys, those disciples who were around him on that day. And this is what he says about them and about this situation. Beginning in verse 6, I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now that I know that everything you have given me comes from you, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them, they knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. That's ending in verse 8 for now. So in these opening phrases, verses here, Jesus says, I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they became mine because they obeyed your word. So here marks the point where Jesus shifts from what we saw yesterday in praying for himself to actively praying for these other guys, specifically his inner group of apostles, those disciples who had been with him and around him through his ministry life so far. Now later in verse 20 onwards, he will actually pray for all believers from the apostles forward who come after that, which of course includes you and me, folks. But in this section we're looking at today, the prayer is for these guys, his own apostles. And Jesus asks for two main things in this passage. He asks for protection from sin, which he unpacks for us in verses 6 to 15. And then in verses 16 to 19, he prays for perfection in service, that their life of ministry be powered and fueled and perfected by the Holy Spirit's presence. Now, this whole process in this whole section, I would like to suggest, can be summed up with the one single theological word that's called sanctification. Jesus prayed for himself to be glorified first, but now he prays for the apostles to be what is called sanctified, set apart. Now Jesus describes the apostles' situation for us. It says they were in the world, but he has also taken them out of the world because he gave them the word from the Father, and importantly because of the fact they took it, they kept it, and they obeyed it. And then he continues, now that they know that everything you have given me comes from me, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they simply accepted them, they know with certainty now that I came from you, and they believe that you, Father God, have sent me to them. Now these verses that form the block we're looking at today, Jesus is emphasizing the need for their sanctification, but also in the second part, their protection as they carry out their ongoing mission in the world, because it is through that protection they will be kept holy, they will be kept sanctified, and they will be perfected in the ability for them to carry out God's mission on earth. Now, reading this passage today, some of the modern day translations make it all seem a little bit cumbersome and repetitive. But I am told by Bible experts who know these things that in the original language, the text is really straightforward. There is a sort of a poetic repetition here. Two sides of a scale being talked about all the time. The disciples are described as being out of the world, but being kept in his word. In other words, they know who Jesus is, and by knowing him, that sets them apart in the world. Now, I need to pause here, I feel, to emphasize that all of us must keep his word before we can really know him for sure. We know who Jesus is, and we know him more fully, all the more fully, as he reveals himself to us. And that is worked out in the direction we choose to take in our life because we choose to do and be obedient to what his word says we should do. So the key principles in these verses is that Jesus is carefully, clearly stating that we have to keep the word, to take on board the word, to apply it in our lives in order that we know him and who he really is and what he really wants out of us in this life. You see, it is as we keep his word that we get to know his blessings, and we also get to experience what he wants for us in our lives. We come to truly know who he is in the sense of what it means and how it is lived out in our lives. Now, this sometimes can almost appear too simple, too easy. In fact, just this week, someone shared to me about an incident where they met with a person, a very well-known Bible teacher and theologian who was visiting this country for a conference, and they themselves were struggling with doubts in spiritual matters. Now, this person who went to them was a pastor themselves, and this person they went to was a very well-known international preacher, and he shared his concerns with him, and he expected to receive a sort of profound answer from this guy. But instead, this famous Bible teacher simply said, "You know in your heart it's all true because you're a Christian and you have chosen to live the Christian life. Therefore, you will have had experiences where the Lord has revealed himself to you through that life." Now, the man was surprised, by the simplicity of the answer. But then he thought about what had happened in his life and what he'd seen in his life, and he realized, you know what, this is true. And I think that illustrates what the Lord is saying. You will know him if you keep his word, because God will manifest himself in your lives and through the events that will occur. Sometimes they may be big things. They may even, if you're blessed in that way, be miraculous things. Don't miss seeing them in the providential work of God in your life and in the life of others. And I would say particular your family. Don't fall into the trap of taking for granted all the amazing things that God has done in your life. All those situations where you thought at one point, there's no hope, I can never see my way round or through this, and yet here you stand today in the grace of God. So Jesus is here, is describing the disciples as living in this state in the world. And then he makes a particular petition, a particular prayer for them. And what he says is found in the following verses. So I'm reading again, beginning from verse 9 now. I pray for them, he says. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given for me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you, Holy Father. So protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None have been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that the scripture could be fulfilled. So Jesus here requests in these verses that his own guys, his disciples here, be kept. Now, of course, that carries on subsequently through disciples in the future, but we'll come to them in more detail tomorrow. But there is this tricky verse at the end where it talks about all being kept safe except one doomed to destruction, so the scripture might be fulfilled. Now, it's a complicated and difficult piece of original Greek text, because there's a play on words going on here. In fact, if you look at the likes of the King James and other older translations, it actually translates it, they're saying, none is lost except the son of loss, or none is perishing except the son of perishing, or none is lost except the son of perdition. Now, there's obviously an exception clause going on here, and it's clearly, when it talks about none is lost, he's talking, remember, to his apostles here, the 12 apostles, and he's saying no one will be lost, but then he has this exception phrase, except one of their number. So he's referring to Judas, and he's saying Judas was lost from the beginning. But setting that verse aside, which is important, true, the main point of the section is that Jesus is praying for his disciples that they be kept safe from the world, living in the world but not of the world. Meaning living in the real world as they continue to minister among people, but praying that he would keep them safe by allowing them to live a life in his name, thereby not adopting any of the world's beliefs or fallen false practices. And he argues that they should be kept because they now belong to God, just as he did. And because he's leaving, then he needs, in a sense, to hand their care over in the everyday to God himself. And he sums this up for us in verses 13 to 15. He says, I am coming to you now, meaning he's coming back, going back to his father, but I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they might have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. So the whole point in the verses up to verse 15 is that Jesus has prayed for the disciples to continue to be kept safe. He's not there anymore. They're left in the world, but he's asking the Lord to keep them, yes, in the world by their activity, but not of the world. They need to be kept safe whilst they are ministering in the world. And I would say this prayer is crucial, not just for the apostles, but for all of us in that fact. Now, let me just pause here take a slight segue and talk about how I believe some Christians over church history have misinterpreted this slightly. This has led some to seek out isolation from the world out of fear, perhaps actually more out of fear of prosecution, or sometimes just out of this idea of fear of contamination. Some in medieval times even became hermits. From early church history, there was a drive to set up monasteries and convents and for believers to cut themselves off from the world. However, I don't believe Jesus is praying about here for that sort of isolation. He's praying for insulation, protection from the things of the world. We are to be in the world, but not of it. A bit like a boat in water without water getting into the boat. This is why the image of the ark in the Genesis flood story is often used as a metaphor for the church in the world. And in this part of the prayer, Jesus has been focusing on his 12 disciples, asking the Father to keep them, to sanctify them, to keep them safe and wholly set apart. Now, there was a famous Bible commentator of the Church of Scotland, a minister called George MacLeod, and he preached a very famous sermon about and talking about this perspective. He once argued in that message, rather poetically, I would say, for what he called the cross in the marketplace. I believe it was preached in the 1950s, but let me just quote a section for it. "I simply argue," he says, "that the cross can be raised again in the centre of the marketplace, as well as on the steeple of our churches. I am recovering the claim that Jesus was not crucified in a cathedral between two candles, but on a cross between two thieves. In fact, on a town garbage heap at the crossroads of politics, a place so cosmopolitan they had to write his title in Hebrew, Latin and Greek. And at the kind of place where cynics met and talked, soldiers gambled and thieves cursed. Because that is where he died, and that is what he died about. So there, this is where we, Christ's men and women, ought to be, and that is what church people ought to be about." So I think MacLeod accurately highlights the reality that Jesus did not die in a sacred, secluded place, but in the middle of the world's messiness, in the middle of the world's sin. And this is crucial for us to understand as we consider our lives, our ministries, in response to his prayer for his disciples and how that might this might apply to us today. One reason we are often ineffective in reaching others is that we by nature as Christians isolate ourselves from the world around us. We tend to surround ourselves with fellow believers, creating a bubble that distances us from those who need the gospel, who need to understand the message and know what Jesus has done for them. In fact, research shows here in the UK that many people who become Christians within 5 to 10 years have no real friends outside the church. And I don't think that's what Jesus ever intended for his followers, to withdraw in that way. Yes, set up communities. Yes, support one another, minister to one another, be accountable to one another, but not in a way that means we withdraw from the world. Instead, he prayed simply that we might have protection from evil whilst we are in the world. So I'll say it again. It's an apt turn of phrase. He prayed for isolation from the things of the world, not insulation. And in this prayer, he emphasizes the need to remain distinct and holy, to be set apart spiritually, while still engaging with the world. And he describes them as the people. These people are the ones he recognizes by the fact they've kept God's word. And because of that, they now know the truth of who he really is, and they're experiencing it by living their lives in a manner obedient to him. And then in the final few verses that we're looking at today, it says this: "They are not of the world, even if I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified." So in the closing verses we're looking at today, 16 to 19, we see Jesus pray that his Father would sanctify them in the truth, the word of truth. So the sanctification being talked about here, it's important to understand it's not just about this idea of personal holiness, which of course is very important, but it's the fact that we are set apart from sin, but we also are set apart for a purpose, and that purpose is the service of God. Jesus sends his disciples into the world, just in a sense as the Father had sent him into the world, implying the same mission and purpose lies behind their sanctification that was always within the plan and purpose of God. The term sanctification confuses some people. It's a big theological word, but it simply means to be set apart for a specific purpose. It's like holiness. Jesus sanctified himself for the sake of his disciples. He set an example of a life dedicated to God's service. Our sanctification involves both, of course, the separation from sin, but it's got to be set apart from stuff to do stuff. And that stuff is fueled by a commitment to serving God's purpose in the world. You see, true sanctification is always going to be a cooperative process involving both God and us. Jesus sends his disciples into the world, and the Father is called upon to sanctify them through his truth, the Word, in their mission in doing that. And we think about it of ourselves today. Our part is also simply to present ourselves as living sacrifices, that which is holy and pleasing to God, that which is set apart, sanctified to God, which I think involves simply a daily commitment to live out his word and being representatives in the world of his word. And I believe that by coming together and doing this, well, you do part of it by joining with me every day as we study the scriptures, but you really do it by taking it out with you when you go out into the world and making it your priority to be obedient to what you've learned. Now, the cultures many of us live in today will prioritize wealth and success and even longevity over having a real purpose in life. But Jesus' prayer reminds us that a single life fully lived for God is what truly matters. We are called to burn brightly for Christ. We're not called to just sit and rot or rust out our time on earth, even if that time is in comfort and safety. So in conclusion, Jesus' prayer for his disciples here, this middle part of his main prayer, is a powerful reminder of our calling also. We are to be in the world, but we're not to be of it. We're to be kept from evil, but sanctified for his service to go and live and minister amongst the evil of this world. Through his word, we are equipped to do that, and we are set apart to fulfill that mission. And let us all commit to living lives that reflect his glory, reflect obedience to his word, but always engaging with the world around us, remaining fully dedicated to his purpose in doing that. So if you've seen so far in this, what I've called the real Lord's Prayer, Jesus pray. And he prayed first for himself, which we looked at yesterday. Then he's prayed for his apostles, which we've looked at today. But finally, he will pray for what he calls his disciples, meaning anyone and everyone who has subsequently become a follower of him. And that means he's going to pray for you, and he's going to pray for me. And we're going to look at that part of this prayer, and we look at it tomorrow. Thanks for being with me today. Thank you for being with me, friends. It's a real privilege to know. I trust if you're here and you're new to this, or you've just come across it, then can I ask that you consider subscribing to this podcast, wherever you get your podcasts from, and that way you'll never miss another single episode. That way you can choose to join me on this journey through the whole Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. New episodes are posted every Monday to Friday, and with occasional bonus episodes and what I call little snapcasts, maybe answers to questions I've received. three little short bonus weekend episodes. Now you can now send me a message and ask me a question. One way of doing it is simply go to where the podcast is hosted, thebibleproject@buzzsprout.com. You may see it wherever you get your podcasts from, but there should be a link which says send me a message. If you're not, you can, on the platform you receive the podcast, but if you want to send me a message, you can go to where it's hosted in BibleProject@buzzsprout.com, send me a message, and I'll try and answer it within about a week or so. The delay is because the podcasts, in an ideal world, are recorded about 7 days before they're actually posted live. But another way you can connect to this ministry, this community, get involved and see and have a wider understanding of what I'm attempting to do, is to come and join our Patreon community. Now, it's free to do that. There's a level at which you can choose just to follow me, and by doing that you'll have access to loads of additional resources, none less being that if you want to, you can listen to a complete ad-free version of the podcast over there. That's all free and freely available. You'll also get things like links to a transcript, a study notes page, even a sermon outline if you wanted to use this passage to bear your own message, and even some study notes for small groups. All of those are free. Now, there are other tiers on Patreon where people have decided to partner with this ministry and make sure all the things that I'm trying to do remain free, and you can do that there also. And as a way of saying thank you to that, I share about 2 bonus episodes a week, usually either transcripts or actual reworkings of talks I've done in secular environments during the week, which is one of my main ministries outside the church, and also occasional Christian messages that I'm sometimes doing at the weekend at churches in my locality. So you'll find all of that available on Patreon. The great thing about Patreon is it enables you to ask me a question or send a message, but more than that, to actually have a conversation with me. That's the place to do it. So Patreon's the place if you want to get a real insight into what's going on in my life and the wider aspects of this ministry. So with that all said, thanks for being with me today. I'm just happy if you've chose to subscribe and make this part of one of the many podcasts that you receive every day and every week, and thereby allowing the Word of God to transform your lives, I trust, in our study of it together. So with that said, it's bye-bye for now.